Hi, everybody. Thanks for tuning in to session 8 of our Story Life groups. So glad that I get to share today. What a privilege. My name is Heidi, and my husband, Chris, and I, we work here at the church in the missions department as well as junior high ministry. And Pastor Dale is away on a Philippines trip, so he asked us to preach this Sunday. And so here I am. And I'm really excited that I got to be in chapter 8, because one of my heroes is found in this part of the story. If you've been reading along, you know that chapter 8 is mixed with the Israelites turning away from God, a lot of heartbreak. And then it's mixed with a few people who decide to be different. They decide to stand up for God, trust Him, and follow Him. And that's where this hero of mine is found. His name is Gideon. If you were there on Sunday, you got to hear us talk more about Gideon. But I thought that for small groups, we would really dig deeper into the beginning of Gideon, and I have an object lesson to do with us in just a minute, but just for review's sake, I wanted to read the first part of the story just to remind you guys, and then we'll get right in. So the beginning, it's on page, I don't know if you're following along in your story Bible. This is the student version, but it's the same as the adult, I think, this part of the story. The angel of the Lord came and sat down under the oak in Ophrah that belonged to Joash the Abiezrite, where his son Gideon was threshing wheat in a wine press to keep it from the Midianites. When the angel of the Lord appeared to Gideon, he said, "The Lord is with you, mighty warrior." "Pardon me, my Lord," Gideon replied. "But if the Lord is with us, why has all this happened to us? Where are all of his wonders that our ancestors told us about? Did not the Lord even bring us out of Egypt? But now the Lord has abandoned us and given us into the hand of Midian." Then the Lord turned to him and said, "Go in the strength you have and save Israel out of Midian's hands. Am I not sending you?" "Pardon me, my Lord," Gideon replied, "but how can I save Israel? My clan is the weakest in Manasseh, and I am the least in my family." The Lord answered, "I will be with you, and you will strike down all the Midianites, leaving none alive." That, if you weren't following in that version, that's in Judges 6, 11 through 16. Now, this testimony is just, it makes me really excited because Gideon's testimony here is become part of my testimony, and it's an invitation for all of us from God. And what's happening here, Gideon, he's living his life the best he knows. He's afraid, and even, it doesn't say there, but in the Bible text, he's hiding in the wine press. He's very fearful. The people, they're being attacked. Their food's being stolen. The circumstances are bad. And he's in there, and all of a sudden, the angel of God comes and tells him something that is hard to believe. He says, "You mighty warrior." Another version says, "man of valor." Now, Gideon's here in this struggle now because he's faced with, wow, God just said something about me, but I don't know if I believe that because of my life. And this is where this mental battle happens for all of us. This is really where one of the huge places of spiritual warfare, it's in our thoughts. It's what are we going to believe? And we've been talking about that throughout all of these chapters. Do we believe the higher story or the lower story? So now Gideon is another example. He's faced with this choice that God has presented to him. And there's three things that are really stopping him, that really challenging him, like I said. One, his feelings are making him think this can't be true because I feel very afraid right now, so you can't be calling me a warrior because warriors are courageous. So his feelings are in question. His circumstance is saying that they've been forgotten by God. They haven't seen miracles in a long time. He's saying, I've never even seen it. I've only heard of that. And so the circumstance, wow, if I was going to be a mighty warrior to fight the Midianites, that would be a miracle, and I've never seen it, so I don't know if I believe that. And then the next thing is his family. If God was going to pick a mighty warrior, you shouldn't pick us because we're the last tribe, and then I'm the last person in the tribe. So I really shouldn't be picked. So he has all these things working against him, and he's really fighting this these things. What do I believe? And isn't that true for Gideon? But that's true for all of us today. We're presented with things in our life, circumstances, feelings, our personality, our experiences, whatever. We're faced with these things and we decide, well, I think my experience is God has not come through before, so I gotta figure it out. So I think that I'm gonna believe that, and I'm not gonna believe that God works all things for good, that nothing's impossible with God. And we start to look to these things instead of looking to the things that God sees about us. I know for me, and I shared some of this on Sunday, when God called our family to move to Zambia, Africa, that really challenged everything I believed about myself, because up to that point in my life, I didn't like flying. I didn't like traveling. I was actually afraid of flying. So for God to call me to travel the world, I'm like, well, that doesn't seem right because I feel afraid of that. And up to that point, I thought, I'm not good at language learning. I'm introverted, so cross-cultural ministry is really hard because that's going to push me out of my comfort zone a lot. I'm going to have to be vulnerable. I'm going to have to be in situations of crowds and people. And I just started concluding, God, I don't know if you picked the right person because everything about me seems wrong. And then God started challenging that because he started speaking a different thing. He started saying, Heidi, you were made for this. Heidi, you can do this. You don't even know the potential that's inside you for this. And now here I'm at this challenge. Well, what am I going to believe? Am I going to believe what God says? Or am I going to believe what the Heidi, the natural Heidi says? And I wrestled with that too, just like Gideon did. And I had to push through. I had to speak different things. I had to recognize lies about myself that I had believed. And just God had to just shatter that way of thinking. And I was like, no, wait, I am made for this. I can learn language. Wait, God does miracles. He can overcome my fears. He can overcome fear of flying, a fear of sickness. Those aren't too hard for him. He parted the Red Sea. He can overcome challenges of provision, everything. And I started speaking and believing higher things. And then God started to change me to become who I am today, just like Gideon had to do. So I heard a testimony, a lady that I really admire, her and her husband. Her name's Wendy Backlund, and she gives this object lesson as part of her testimony. She was in a time of her life where God was pushing her to believe for higher things, but she was really afraid of disappointment. She was afraid, well, what if that seems too prideful or it's not true or, you know. And she was wrestling and she was pushing to grow, but she still had a ways to go. And there was a time where people were praying over her, and maybe three different instances, separate instances, people prayed and they said, you know, I see God saying that you're going to write books. And then, you know, time would go by and someone else would pray and they'd say, I see God that you're going to really be an author. You're going to write books. And so she had been given this prophetic word, but she was there and she was thinking, who would ever want to read one of my books? Like, I don't even know what I would say. And she was thinking, well, if God wants me to write a book, then he's just going to like zap me with some book idea and it's just going to come alive. And she just really wasn't, she just let it go and wasn't pursuing it. Then one day God was just kind of whispering to her and said, I want you to just start declaring you write books. And so she was sitting there and she was thinking, well, God, wouldn't that be lying? Because I've never written a book. And then God gave her this picture, and this is the object lesson. He told her, he said, well, Wendy, is it lying to call an apple tree before it's ever produced any apples? And she sat there and she thought of it and she thought of this a little tree and she was like, well, God, I guess not. I guess it's called an apple tree because it's gonna have apples. And God's like, yes, it's called an apple tree because of the potential that's inside of that tree. And so God started to speak to her and say, I see things that you're capable of now that you haven't produced the fruit of yet. And I want you to start believing for the things that I see in you. And so that really challenged her and she just started, okay, God, I'm gonna start speaking it. Because, you know, remember last week we learned that faith comes by hearing. So if you want to have a different thought, you need to hear a different thing. And she just started saying, okay, I write books. For several months, whenever she thought of it, I write books. I write books. I'm an author. And her faith began to rise till finally one day she was like, okay, I think I'm going to try to write a book. And, you know, it was a process of her writing it, but she ended up writing two books on her own up to this point, and her husband, that they've kind of co-authored some, they have several books. And those two books are incredible. They have been life-changing books for me, like completely. And I just think, what if Wendy wouldn't have ever thought, yeah, I could write a book. What if she would have stopped? What if she wouldn't have pushed more for that potential? And that's just me. There's so many testimonies, and I know there's so many more books inside of her. And I just think, yes, God, you see things in us that we don't know yet. We might be this small tree that hasn't fully come alive to all that is possible to us. More than just apples, there's a ton of potential. That story, Gideon and Wendy's, it just blew the limits off of my thinking. And I just started believing, God, you know what? If you're inside of me, then the potential of what you could use me for, I don't even know. I'm not going to base my conclusions of my potential just only on my feelings, my circumstances, my experiences. I'm going to look differently. And that's what this invitation is for us, this Gideon story. It's to remind us that there's a higher calling than we even know. So I wanted to encourage you guys Maybe some of you've had things spoken over you, like Wendy, maybe a word given. You're gonna write a book, you're gonna lead worship, you're gonna be a teacher, missionary, whatever. Maybe you have that, but maybe you don't have that. And we're not supposed to sit around and wait for an angel to appear to us. We're not supposed to wait for somebody to speak it. We're supposed to start right now with God's word. What has He already said about me and my potential that I haven't fully even believed yet? Let me start with the promises of God. Let me start with the New Testament and looking at Jesus's life. I had a few verses that I wanted to share with you. In 2 Corinthians 5:17, it says, "Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old has gone, the new is here. From the time you accepted Christ, you have become a new creation." So your new creation has incredible potential. It's not all limited to just the natural you. The next verse is John 14:12. "Very truly I tell you, whoever believes in me will do the works I have been doing, and they will do even greater things than these, because I am going to the Father." So here God is saying, for those who believe in Him, we will do things that Jesus did, even greater things. So we can just start, well, what did Jesus do? Well, He heard God's voice was one thing. Maybe some of you have assumed, I don't really hear from God. Or I thought I did, but I got it wrong, so it's not really my gift. That's not the truth. The truth is, His sheep know His voice. The truth is, you will hear from God. You do hear from God. Now, maybe you have to grow in your hearing. All of us have to grow. But that is part of a new creation. We get to hear from God. We get to pray for the sick. God says that we're going to do greater things. Well, He prayed for the sick. Another verse in Isaiah 61:1 says, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me because the Lord has anointed me to proclaim the good news to the poor." That part stood out to me because I was called to go to Zambia to proclaim the good news. Before, I thought, I'm not a good missionary. I don't know how to proclaim the news in cross-cultural. And then I thought, wait, if God's in me, He came to proclaim the good news so I can proclaim the good news. And that confidence just started rising up in me. And now I have no doubt, I am called to proclaim the good news to all people. It goes on that He sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for the captives, to release from darkness the prisoners. Those are some of the things that you will do. And I just really want to encourage you, go deeper, read some more verses, and start to shift it into a declaration. Take it not just from the verse, but just say, okay, God, if you're in me and you said I'm going to do greater things than you and you did this, then I'm going to believe that's possible for me. And I want you to start recognizing things that maybe you say that just really put limits on your experience with God, limits on what you're capable of doing. Maybe you just have decided that I'm only good with a certain age of people. And maybe it's true that you're really great with high school kids. But the higher truth is, Jesus is in you. He loves people. He loves people of all ages, all races, all genders, all cultures. And if that's in you, then you love all kinds of people. And your potential to love and serve all kinds of people is limitless. It's amazing. You can do more than you think. I just want to release faith and God's thoughts to come as you and your group meet and discuss. I want you to remember things that maybe God spoke to you in the past, maybe somebody else spoke over you, things that you have not believed for, you thought it couldn't be. And I just encourage you, go back, believe higher, go for more. And I bless you guys today. Thank you.